Please be aware of the conflicts that are involved. These are the conflicts of interest that I have. So what we will do is run through a couple of things. One is understand the role of biosimilars in clinical practice. To understand this, the first thing to do is to know the difference between a drug. What is a drug? A drug is a medicine or other substance which has a physiological effect when ingested or otherwise introduced into the body. Now, we are all familiar with generic drugs. Generic drugs are chemical and therapeutic equivalents of a low molecular weight whose patent has expired. India has a huge generic market, and most of it is generic. We know about progression to generics. They have a huge share in the thing. Then why are we concerned about biosimilars? One is, most biosimilars are biopharmaceuticals. What is a biopharmaceutical? A biopharmaceutical is a drug that we have outsourced to somebody else, which means we get another molecule, we get another organism, and we ask that organism to make this drug for us. The classic example is insulin. If you see this particular slide, you will notice that in this corner, you have this very little product that's aspirin, and on the other side, this is huge thing is erythropoietin. So why are we worried about using biosimilars? Simply, what is a biosimilar? Biosimilar is a drug where someone else has re-engineered the same thing to do the same different product. And why are we afraid? Simply because it's very, very complex. So just look at this. This is aspirin is the one that's easily done. That's insulin. There's erythropoietin. And can you see monoclonal antibodies here? That's really, really huge. So a biosimilar is a biologic medicine developed to be similar to an already existing product that's already approved for human use. And that's really why we are worried about biosimilars. So the first thing to remember is that making a protein itself is very difficult. Can I have a piece of paper? So every time you prescribe insulin or you prescribe a biologic, remember there is something that's happening. So we all think of proteins as this, a sequence of amino acids. But actually, proteins are something different. So a sequence of amino acids are there. They undergo one fold. They undergo a second fold. They undergo a third fold. And depending on the complexity of this molecule, different parts of it are exposed. And because different parts of this are exposed, when you try to recreate it, even outsourcing it to another organism, you're going to find that this is not so easy. So these are the nomenclatures that are present. But why do we need biosimilars? We need biosimilars simply because that we want competition and we want things to be cheaper. So what are the issues? One, a high molecular weight. The second thing I told you, a complex three-dimensional structure. Third, most of these have very, very complex modes of action. For example, if you take insulin, one of the things that you always worry about insulin is whether it goes and stimulates the IGF receptor, because when the IGF receptor is stimulated, you can have mitogenicity. Third, we don't produce it in a lab, we are not controlling it, a third organism is controlling it. Lastly, it can elicit an immune response. So these are the issues. The manufacturing process is complex. You are depending on another biological activity for doing this. It's difficult to characterize, and there are, of course, unknown differences. Remember that even when insulin is made, there are batch-to-batch variations for each of these. So this is how insulin is synthesized. Then it's converted into an hexamer. So can you do this without doing the original molecule? And it looks like we can. So this is the steps of insulin presentation. This is the biosimilar glargine and how it is made in the lab. And you'll notice it has almost the same way, but here another organism is used. This is the manufacturing process. So what are the challenges in making a biosimilar? One is challenges in making an active ingredient. The second is challenges in making a pure product. So the question is, are any two biologicals different? Are any two different insulin molecules the same? We know that most of these insulin molecules are different. It's like a snowflake. Every single molecule is actually different. So that is why, and have we been burnt before? The first time erythropoietin was brought into the market as a biosimilar, it actually had problems and it had to be taken off the market. Similarly, the novel insulin that was present, the Novolog insulin, had to be taken off the market. So some point of time, various regulatory agencies have gotten together and created an approval process for biosimilar insulins. This is the FDA pathway. I'm just going to tell you the salient differences, what happens. Many times when people come to you and talk to you about insulins, they would tell you that this is the phase 3 study, this is the phase 4 study, this is what we have. In a biosimilar insulin, it's the complete opposite. In a regular molecule, you have a smaller preclinical phase, you have a larger clinical phase. In a biosimilar, you don't have to show the efficacy. You just have to show it's equal to the original molecule. The only thing that you have to show is it is exactly the same. And how do you do that? In your clinical practice, how do you know that the insulin that some company has brought to you and saying it's a biosimilar is exactly the same as the insulin that you've been using, that the original molecule's being made? For example, what about Sanofi's Lantus with somebody else's Lantus? And the answer is the pharmacodynamics. So these are all the steps that people go to. They go through a phase 1, they go to a phase 2, they go to a phase 3, a bioequivalence plan. And you will notice, what do we need to do to find out what biosimilars are? The first thing is to make sure it's not mitogenic. So you have IGF-1 assays. You have to do animal PD, but dose toxicity is not required. Then you do a lot of physicochemical characterization. You do mass spectrometry. You look at peptide matching. You look at structure. You do NMR studies. This is a physicochemical characterization of basal insulin glargine as well as glargine, and you can find out there's no difference. These are the physicochemical characterization studies that show no difference. This is an analytical comparison that shows that the biosimilar glargine and this glargine are absolutely the same, even though it's made by two different organisms. The most important, and I would always tell you, if someone came to you when you're busy in your clinic and you said, oh, our biosimilar is as good as anything else, and you want to ask, what is the one question you want to ask? Show me your PD. So these are in vitro tests, but this is the reason I wanted to show you. This is the original human marvel, and this is withdrawn from the market. Can you see the difference in the PD, the pharmacodynamics? They're completely different. On the other hand, the PK/PD, the pharmacokinetic for Biocon's glargine, and this is the pharmacodynamics, this is the EMA study, they're absolutely spot on. You can't find out the difference. And that is what tells you that these are similar. Remember, if a pharmaceutical company and says that our biosimilar glargine is better than the original glargine, or our insulin is better than the original insulin, then you need to laugh at them. Because if it's better, then the product is different. It needs to be exactly the same. It needs to do exactly the same things. Its A1C reductions must be the same. Its glucose reductions must be the same. Importantly, this particular graph, if at all, there's one thing you want to tell people, show me the graph. And this is the only graph that you want to see. All right? So the only other thing that you want to ask is, what is the immunogenicity? You want to find out that it's not making any antibodies that are harmful. So this is the immunogenicity study. This is the Indian phase 3 studies. And you will find that these are absolutely the same. This is the global study. And this is the INSTRIDE study that looks at A1C endpoints. And you will find out that there's absolutely no difference between. It's just back, spot on, just back. And that's really what you want. You don't want differences. You don't want better A1Cs. Again, if somebody comes and says, sir, our insulin is much better, our A1Cs are great, then tell him, go, you know what, I don't want to see you again. You want to see, it's absolutely the same. This is the dose over time, doesn't change. Can you see, you remember the difference between U300 and U100? The potency actually comes down with U300. You need a higher dose with U300. This is U100 glargine made by Sanofi and by Biocon, and these are absolutely the same. Nocturnal hypoglycemia is the same. So basically, what I've shown you is what you need to look for in a biosimilar. That the PK/PD needs to be the same. The immunogenicity needs to be the same. It shouldn't cause immunogenicity over time. That the A1C reduction and the glucose and the hypoglycemia are all the same. And I think this we have established in both the EMA studies as well as the European studies. This is the A1C in the INSTRIDE 2 data. And you will find that the A1C is completely the same. I really love this particular study. It's nice. And the doses don't change over time. And you have 24-week, you have 52-week data in the Japanese study. No hypoglycemias. And that's really what you have. So I'm sorry to hold the few of you back who stayed back. for this industry spotlight. We're grateful for the industry spotlight because this is a way for us to show our thankfulness to our sponsors who helped us through this, and for the 30 or 40 of you who stayed here. These are my summaries. Why are biosimilars important? I think they are an exciting new part of life. The biosimilar conference in the world today attracts over 10,000 people every year. So many people think that this is going to happen. And every company that has said that we hate biosimilars is investing in biosimilars. So that's really what's happening. That includes Eli Lilly. That includes Sanofi. That includes all the others. So biosimilars are here to stay. When guidelines are adhered to, and there are Indian guidelines now, and there are EMA and Japanese guidelines, if they're adhered to, and companies follow them, and you demand proof of this, these are viable alternatives. At this point of time, biosimilars are not exactly have become as cheap as we want them to. For example, glargine, I think there's a 35 rupees difference. I'd like to see a much greater spread, but it's a start. I think what's important is they give our patients the alternatives that are required. And in markets like ours, where cost is important, these cost differences are important. So this is an exciting piece of information. Thirdly, I want to leave you again and again with one question. Whenever someone comes and tells you, this is our biosimilar, what should I look at? Show me the PK/PD graph. And then say, show me that the A1C reductions are exactly the same. The glucose reductions are exactly the same. And there are no the same. Everything else is mumbo jumbo. I don't think I would recognize the NMR spectroscopy if it came and danced in front of me. So I wouldn't know that. So, and finally, to plug in our sponsor's product, to remember that this particular molecule, which is Basalog, which is a glargine equivalent, appears to meet the requirements of a safe and effective alternative to the innovator glargine. And interestingly, many of us in the audience sitting here patiently listening to me while I drone on and on have a lot of experience with this molecule even before it went through the EMA studies. Again, thank you for actually staying put. I really love the fact that so many of you stayed back. Thank you. Any questions quickly? Dr. Das, you want to make a comment?
So, I just want to say, as you rightly said, they have come to stay. Indian market, rightly said, not only brand conscious, but price conscious. I also wanted to say that insulin, erythropoietin, etc., must be available to everybody. And we cannot be monopoly on it.
My question is whether Basalog is approved by EMA right now, because as per my knowledge, it is only Abacaclar by Lilly, which has been approved and marketed. The reason behind that, probably Abacaclar is not coming in India because of the cost issue. Because the development process, as you said, is very complex, and I think they could not reduce the price as the Indian market. Anybody from...
It is approved.
Yeah.
So the Japanese is approved.
PMDA has approved it already. And as sir was presenting, Strike 1 and 2, which has been the global phase 3 trial conducted in the European part, which has been accepted for the review. So we are awaiting for that approval.
Okay, because India is only country, I think, in the whole world. We have a lot of biosimilars are there.
That's not true. So
no, with concert 2, I am just concentrating on insulin, not on erythropoietin. If you see, like, go to Sri Lanka, there is no biosimilar insulin is available right now because they follow WHO guidelines of approval of it.
So there are two questions. I think there are biosimilars in other parts of the world that include insulin. For example, Japan, biosimilar insulin is approved. Latin America is a big biosimilar market at this point of time. Yes, you want to answer it?
Yeah, we do have our biosimilar insulins in both Sri Lanka as well as in UAE. Now, the Basalog has been available.
And it's available. I mean, I actually was part of the launch group when we did this in Malaysia, so it's available in Malaysia. It's now available in Vietnam. So at least I know the bit about insulin. The Lilly's glargine is in a patent suit with Sanofi in the U.S. So that's really what's going on. But I think each market is being breached at this point of time. So I know that at least basal insulin glargine is available now in Malaysia. It's available in Vietnam. It's available in Sri Lanka. And now it's available in UAE. And more importantly, to me, the toughest market for any molecule is not the US FDA or the EMA, but Japan. The Japanese have some of the best requirements.
Yeah. The last question is, what is the difference between the price between Lantus
that
and
you should
say right now?
Have approximately 20% price difference vis-a-vis with
Any other questions? No other questions. I think we have actually, you know, done more than a paleo diet by sitting through this talk. So let's go have some really good lunch that's served at both places. And again, thank you all for being here.